To Potomac Hills Presbyterian Church, the live stream version. Glad that you all can make it today. I'm Tom Gardner, one of your ruling elders, and I'm happy to be worshiping with you today. The materials that you need are able to be found on the worship document that's on our church website. Hopefully you receive that in email. If not, you can go to potomachills.org and you can find that under the worship materials. The lyrics for the songs that we're going to be singing are there. So I'd ask you to go ahead and open that up, and we're going to start with our first hymn today, which is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. I don't know about you, but I definitely can use blessing in this time. So Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount above. Wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let that grace now, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. If you look in your worship documents, you'll see the announcements for today. Obviously, we have a whole schedule of different activities that are going on within the church, community groups, and Bible studies. Please look at the dates for that. Also, a youth large group will meet this Wednesday, January 13th, beginning at 6:30. That's a Zoom meeting, so make sure you go to it through Zoom. Also, a big important announcement this upcoming Saturday next week, Tree of Life is seeking food donations. And so as we've done in the past very successfully, we've been able to get lots of food for Tree of Life. We're going to be doing that again this upcoming Saturday, basically from 11 to 12:30 on Saturday here at the church office. If you want to drive up in your car, you can have your food donation items, basically non-perishable foods. John Spence and myself will be here. We can even take it out of the car for you. You don't even have to get out. And we will load it into one of our vehicles and then bring that to Tree of Life for their food donation. If you miss Saturday, you can also bring it on Sunday to the worship service. But if you need a list of what they need, basically, you can go to Tree of Life Ministries. That's tolministries.org/services/food. And that's in your bulletin as well. So please consider doing that. We've always had a good showing of the amount of food that we've brought, and it will help to or serve to help the people in our area who need food this time of year. Also, keep in mind that our missions trip to the Carolina Mountain Mission in Haywood, North Carolina is currently a go. We're looking forward to doing that again this year. We weren't able to go last summer due to the pandemic and some COVID restrictions, but as of now, things look like they're good to go, and so we are looking forward to doing that. If you're interested in doing that, the registration and $100 deposit is due by February 14th. So Valentine's Day. If you would like more information about that, please contact Frank Wong here at the church about that. As always, we have small groups that are meeting. Please consider joining those. If you'll look at the call to worship, we're going to go ahead and enter into our call to worship to the Lord. And obviously, I'm the leader and you're the people, but I'll be reading both parts today. One note, the very last leader people entry is actually not part of Psalm 78. That's a mistake that I made when I was putting this together. It's from Joshua, which is still God's word, but I think we'll just leave that part off and just read the initial verses there. So I apologize for that. Live and learn. But our call to worship today is from Psalm 78, verses 1 and 2, and then 35 through 39. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known, that our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, but tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might, and the wonders that he has done. They remembered that God was their rock, the Most High God, their Redeemer. But they flattered him with their mouths. They lied to him with their tongues. Their heart was not steadfast toward him. They were not faithful to his covenant. Yet he, being compassionate, atoned for their iniquity and destroyed them. He restrained his anger often and did not stir up all his wrath. He remembered that they were but flesh, a wind that passes and comes not again. Let's go ahead and bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, eager and anxious to hear your word. We need it, Lord. We need your word so badly in our lives, and we need your spirit to come and fill us so that we may dwell upon your word and learn from your word and grow from your word. And so we're thankful that we have your word today. We pray, Lord, that you'd be with us as we are doing our worship service through the live stream. We pray that people would still tune in and that they would benefit from hearing the worship and participating in that. We pray that families would come together and find this an easy process to do, Lord. We pray, of course, for the Nelson family who has caught COVID, and we know that they're doing well, that they're recovering from that, but we just pray, Lord, that you continue to be with them. Help them during this morning worship to still be able to worship you and to glorify you in their worship. Father, we ask that you would put your blessing upon us today, each in our own homes and each in our own space. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you'll turn in your bulletins, we're going to go ahead and continue with our worship of the Lord.
Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory, every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days, for none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days, for none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory, every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days.
Amen. This one takes us back a little bit. Very appropriate for our day to day. Thy word.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're here right beside me, and nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and a light unto my
excellent word. What more can he say than to you he hath said, you who unto Jesus for refuge have fled. Fear not, I am with thee, O be not dismayed, for I am your God and will still give you aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand, upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. With rivers I call thee to go. The rivers of grief shall not thee overflow, for I will be with thee, thy troubles to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert to his foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to break, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
Amen. We've come to the time in our worship where we're going to enter into prayer towards our Lord and with our Lord. As your bulletin notes, these prayers are adapted from a book called To You I Lift Up My Soul by Dr. Michael Philiber, a senior pastor at Heritage Presbyterian Church in Oklahoma City, and A Book of Prayers, A Prayer for Every Chapter of the Bible by Reverend Stephen McGee of Exeter Presbyterian Church in Exeter, New Hampshire. The congregation will pray in unison the parts in bold print, and of course I'll read it all for you as well. So, this is from Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11. Please read with me. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. Amen. Sovereign God, we pray on behalf of your church throughout the world, for this congregation and for those who serve us within the Presbyterian Church in America. Today we pray specifically for our sister PCA churches in Northern Virginia. Fill them with your Holy Spirit and bless the worship services in person and online of First Asian Indian Presbyterian Church in Herndon, Virginia, and their pastor, Reverend Yayar Chinavan, and Grace Covenant Presbyterian Church in Herndon, Virginia, and their pastors, Reverend Paul Wong and Reverend Arthur Sue. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, in accordance with Isaiah 55, our text for today, we come to you hungry and thirsty. You will satisfy us with your abundance that can only be found in the bread of life and cup of our salvation. Your ways are high and your thoughts are pure. Your word has accomplished what you have purposed by your holy decree. Help us to believe and obey it. Lord, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, you have taught us in your holy word that you do not willingly afflict or grieve the children of men. Look with kindness upon the sorrows and needs of these facing suffering, grief, and loss at this time. Remember them in mercy, nourish their souls with patience, comfort them with a sense of your goodness, lift up your countenance upon them, and give them peace and wholeness. Lord, hear our prayer. O Sovereign Father, who rules and reigns over all the earth, we come before you today remembering that you are mighty and excellent God. You brought your people Israel out of the bondage of oppression, and despite their wanderings, which led their hearts away from you, you took them from the wilderness and brought them into a land of abundance. We remember that you asked them only that they love you and worship you alone, and that you would be to them a God and a Father, a King and a brother. If they held true to you, serving you and worshiping you, then you would be with them, their champion among their enemies, their comfort amid the trials of life, both their present and their future hope. We remember these things, Father, and we recall that your people turned from you. despite your provision, they turn to the idols that so captivated their fallen minds and hearts. They fell in love with wood and stone, earth and metal, giving their hearts, their souls, and even their bodies to such things. They sought to trade their eternal covenantal relationship with you for the lie of the momentary pleasures of the present. They attempted to coerce the favor of images instead of humbling themselves before you and giving themselves into your presence. We remember all these things, Father, but we forget that in so many ways we are just like the Israelites of old. And so we come today, Father, first of all, seeking your forgiveness. We too, despite being given the fulfillment of all the promises of your prophets, as found in our Messiah, our Christ, the Lord Jesus, have so often made the choice to not trust in you. We have made the choice, Father, to put our hopes in the false idols that surround us. We have sought deliverance from the hands of kings and presidents, like the people and the nations around us. We are a people with one King, Jesus Christ, who is our faithful champion, and yet so often, when the tides change and the winds begin to blow, we falter and feel like we are alone. Please forgive us, Father. In the midst of our belief, we pray that you would help us in our unbelief. Father, we are a nation divided. We see ourselves as black or white. We see ourselves as rich or poor. We see ourselves as the righteous and the other guy as the unrighteous. We see ourselves as men or women or even as some derivative of the two. We are those of the mask and those of the no mask. We are the in-person worshipers and those that stay at home. We are the fearful and we are also the prideful. We are divided on so many fronts, Father. Help us as Christians to lead the way in unity. Help us to lead by example, and that example not within ourselves, but solely in the example of your Son, Jesus. Help us to get into your word and out of our Facebooks. Help us to turn off the televisions and turn on the prayers. Help us to lose ourselves in seeking to be a blessing to others. We need your Spirit, Father, to do this. We cannot do it on our own. We need your Spirit to dwell within us in power and to move us to act like the people you want us to be. We need your Spirit to move us to sacrificial loving. We need your Spirit to push us to sacrificial giving. We need your Spirit in abundance, Father. Oh, how we need it. Pour your Spirit upon us, Father, we pray. Father, I lift up to you now the words of Brian Chappell, the stated clerk of our denomination, when he asks us to pray these words today all across the nation. He prays and we pray with him. Heavenly Father, the events of the past week as well as the transition of leadership and upcoming days give us much cause to seek your mercy and grace for our nation. If we have not shown proper respect for everyone, we ask forgiveness for sins of anger, arrogance, violence, and willful blindness. Remembering our Savior's instruction to ask forgiveness for our debts as we forgive our debtors. We pray for those in authority over us as your word instructs. We pray for the courage to honor those who serve as civil magistrates by your permission and for your sovereign purposes. Finally, we ask that you remind us not to put our trust in princes, but to trust in the Lord who is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. The nations may rage, but we take our refuge in you. You alone are our strength and shield. To you alone may our spirits yield. We pray in Jesus' name, Father. Amen. If you'll look again in your bulletins and read with me this response in unison. O God, all of these spoken requests and all of our unspoken requests we present to you in the caring name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. Let's take a moment just to bow our heads and confess our own private sins to the Lord. Maybe as families, take this time as families at home to do so. And then we'll come back together for our corporate confession. Let's bow our heads and pray individually. You'll join me again. We're going to confess our corporate sins in unison here. Father, teach us not to sin with such abandon. We do it all so easily, pretend, lie, envy, lust, criticize, brood, ignore, deny, consume, hoard, defame, distort, make excuses, and then expect an easy forgiveness for the asking. God, forgive us for our negligence of your holy character. Let us not misinterpret your patience with our sin as though it were permissiveness. Loving Father, astonish us with a wholesome, godly fear, which will not drive us to despair, but cause us to number our days and get us hearts of wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters, let's hear the assurance of pardon. This is from Acts 4, verse 12. God's word tells us, "And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Amen. With those words, I'd ask that people again join me in singing our offering hymn, our offering song. Obviously, we're not together to give our tithes and offerings, but you can certainly mail those to the church office as the Lord leads you. The song is Stand in Awe, so if you are able and feel led to do so at home, please join me in standing for our offering to the Lord.
All right. Well, we will be in Isaiah 55 today. But before we get there, I didn't want to address this week's events at the Capitol. I rarely speak publicly about such events, and when I do, I invariably upset someone. So I do it with some measure of trepidation. But this event was unique in that it publicly involved professing Christians, including two people that I know. The two people I know who attended the rallies have given public assurances they had no part in the riots that followed. They both have claimed that there were professional agitators present. Media reports have confirmed the presence of well-known, easily identifiable QAnon members, neo-Nazi white supremacists, other alt-right protesters, none of whom represent Christ. But what I want to consider today is there were people there who publicly professed Christ. And how do people who publicly profess the name of Jesus in word and on signs end up breaking and entering, causing the destruction of public and private property, and put others in harm's way? And I know there's only been a few days to sort of ponder the sad state of affairs, and I'm sure there's lots of possible and probable answers to this question, but I've come up with at least three fairly basic answers. And that's that these people do not know, or they do not trust God. They do not know, or they do not trust God's word. They do not know, or they do not trust God's work. Either these people are believers in name only, and then we shouldn't be surprised when they act as unbelievers because that's what they actually are. Or they are believers in Christ, but simply do not know or do not care that believers are supposed to live in a way that adorns the profession of the gospel and their manner of life, to quote the ordination vows of our elders and deacons. Why do we have Christians who do not trust God, God's word, or God's work? And it's easy to just say that they're spiritually immature, and that's probably true. And it's also easy to say that if they attend a church at all, perhaps they come from a spiritually immature church, one that hasn't taught them to trust God or his word. One of the few observations of my dissertation, even from 15 years ago, was how few Bible-believing churches actually use the Bible in a meaningful way over a long period of time. And immature churches produce immature Christians who do things which bring shame to the name of Christ. Now, since to the best of my knowledge, none of these people come from this church, and therefore none of them are under my spiritual authority or guidance, I can do nothing about those who took part in Wednesday's attack on the Capitol, except to pray, which I have and will continue to do. And yet, I've been wrestling with a question all week long, or at least since Wednesday. I mean, it's easy to look down and throw stones at the people that were there. But how do we keep from becoming like those spiritually immature people who, in the words of Francis Schaeffer, have hurt the witness of the church to a watching world? And since in a few moments I'll be preaching on having confidence in God's word, I want to focus my remarks there. You can consider this to be the sermon application before the sermon. One of the great advantages, I think, of being at Potomac Hills is we want you to, as 2 Peter 3:18 says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that means we have to make every effort to build our knowledge and trust in God and his word. And every effort involves showing up. Every effort involves becoming a hearer and doer of God's word. Every effort starts with the personal reading of the scriptures. And there's no shortcut. You just have to take time to open the book and read it. And yet the good news is that we offer several ways to help you do that. First, you need to hear God's word. The pastors and elders and teachers put in time that by and large you don't have, so that the word of God is preached and taught well here at Potomac Hills. And therefore, in order to hear God's word well, You need to make coming to worship a high priority for you and your family. Coming in person and coming online both count, but you have to come. Dr. Tom Rainer is one of the folks who monitors church trends in this country, and his surveys indicate that people now consider themselves a regular attender if they make it to worship 3 out of every 8 weeks. If you come 3 out of every 8 weeks, you're well on your way to spiritual immaturity. But with your help, we'll do all that we can to prevent that from happening. Second, you not only need to hear God's word, but you need to read it and study it as well. One of the best places to do that is in our Sunday school program. Providentially, our combined adult, college, and teen classes just started the book of Revelation. So if you want to see what Jesus thinks of spiritually immature churches, come to this class. In a couple weeks, we're going to get into the study of the 7 churches in Revelation 2 and 3. And by and large, those are spiritually immature churches, and we're going to see what Jesus has to say to them. And there's actually a lot there that's going to help us from becoming like them. Third, you not only need to hear and read God's word, you also need to speak it to others and have others speak it to you. It's one of the main reasons we have community groups. Yes, it's an opportunity to build relationships and pray for each other throughout the week, but it's also designed in discussing the sermons to speak God's word into each other's lives. Those who have no one to speak God's word into their lives are at a great disadvantage in terms of spiritual growth. And with the online options we offer, several of our community groups meet online. The pandemic is not an excuse not to participate. If anything, the relational disconnects the pandemic has caused in our lives should give us greater motivation for greater connection. There's no reason for anyone in this church to struggle with loneliness, and yet I know a few do. So let's strive to be connected. Let's strive to be one with the other and to practice speaking God's word into each other's lives. As Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. The bottom line is this. If you're not in a position to hear God's word, read God's word, and speak God's word, then it will eventually be revealed in a life of spiritual immaturity. And it's only a matter of time until you end up doing things which bring shame to the name of Christ. And I'm begging you, don't let yourself drift into immaturity. It leads to no good place and accomplishes no good thing. And I'm confident that doesn't have to happen. I love this church as I know you do, and we're actually in a great position to hear and to read and to speak God's word to one another. As Colossians 1:28 says, him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom that we may present everyone mature in Christ. So let's mark this new year as spiritually mature people who trust God, who trust God's word, and who trust God's work in this world. Thanks. With that said, let's now attend to God's word. Turn with me to Isaiah 55. Normally, I'm waiting for all the kids to leave and go to children's church, and I don't have that pause here. Isaiah 55, verses 1 through 13. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear, that your soul may live. And I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you, because the Lord your God and of the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. A word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this is your word, and we need it. We especially need it now. Thank you for giving us the scriptures and making us your people. Once again, we've come to your word, and we find ourselves in a passage that some of us have often quoted, but rarely studied. So once again, we thank you for this prophet, for this extraordinary word you gave him to preach to those facing exile. Give us hearts and minds to believe and understand all that you have written and put into practice in our lives. Help us to know you better and to love you more through Isaiah 55. And so we pray, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, help us see Jesus. For in his name we pray. Amen and amen. Last month, an amazing thing happened at the Dairy Queen in Brainerd, Minnesota. I don't know where Brainerd, Minnesota is, but amazing things happened there. And on Thursday, December 3rd, a man decided to pay for the order of the person in the car behind him at the drive-thru at the Dairy Queen. And the store manager, a woman named Tina Jensen, said after the first man paid for someone else's order, she told the next person in line what he'd done. She said, a lady pulled up, and I said, just to let you know, the gentleman in front of you paid for your order. If you would like, I can pay it forward, and you can pay for the order of the car behind you, and we can keep this going. And she's like, really, why would he do that? And I said, we just have it every once in a while where someone will take care of the person behind him, and today's your lucky day. So she paid for the person behind her, and it continued from there. Car after car, hour after hour. The store began updating their fans on Facebook. They went from 48 cars to 150 cars to more than 275 cars. And that night when they closed, they posted, we're still going strong. Over 275 cars have paid it forward. If we can keep it going like this, we'll be opening tomorrow with money forward. Way to go, DQ fans. And so the next day, the store posted in the morning, or during the day, it said the power of one small act yesterday during lunch continued throughout the night. Every fan for the remainder of the day paid it forward, resulting in over 280 cars. The night ended with $10 being paid forward, and we'll continue making memories and start out paying it forward today. We're all in this together, one red spoon at a time. Dairy Queen uses red spoons. That one small act of kindness of this one man continued to be paid forward for 2.5 days with over 900 drivers taking part. As that noted theologian John Krasinski says, we can use some good news. Perhaps such a thing has happened to you. We have a number of specialty coffee lovers in the house. Occasionally, one of you will mention, pulling up to the drive-through window only to discover the person in the car in front of you has already paid for your order. Like, how many of you has that happened to? It'd be great if I could see you raise your hands, but I can't. So I assume it's happened to some of you. And I think it's great when it does happen. I mean, there's still a transaction. There's still a price to be paid, but not by you. You buy without money and without price. So here's the point, and I hope by now it's clear. The gospel's not free. Pardon is not free. But the Lord Jesus Christ, God has already paid in advance through Jesus in full at the cross and the suffering of his son. He's purchased everything your soul needs. And it's free to you now because it's cost him everything. The spiritual junk food in which we spend our labor trying to glut the hungers in our souls, that's going to cost us. But the prophet Isaiah says in the first verse of our text today, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Spiritual maturity is based first and foremost on the conviction that God has spoken to us. And he's used words as the means of this powerful and effective verbal communication from the Lord. Our active and creative God has chosen to use words and to accomplish his purposes through words. Confidence in the power of God's words is fundamental to spiritual maturity. If God's words are powerful and effective, then we have to hear them. Our focus here is on the power of God's word to create and sustain believers. It's a crucial message from the Old Testament that Christ applied to himself in the desert when he was tempted to turn stones into bread. Matthew 4:4, taken from Deuteronomy 1:12, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Spiritual maturity means hearing words that have come from the mouth of God. Now, if you think about it, we have a moral duty to pay attention to the words of others, to discipline our hearing, our concentration, so we not only hear the words, but we listen for the meaning in order to understand the significance of the words to the person who's speaking them. And that takes love and patience and humility, especially when we have to admit that we've misheard or we've misunderstood what they've said, or that we didn't hear them at all because we simply weren't paying attention. Well, if you think about that, we owe the same duty to God, if not more so. See, in your relationships, the longer you've known someone, the more attentively that you've listened to them in the past, the more patience and love you have for them, the more likely you are to understand the meaning of their words to us today. It's the same thing with God. Of course, we can get it wrong. We can be deaf to what God says to us in the scriptures. We can misunderstand, we can misconstrue God's meaning. But the fact that we may misunderstand doesn't mean that we can never understand. It is not only our duty, it should be a joy to hear, receive, and obey the words that God has spoken to us through scripture so that God accomplishes his good purpose in and through our lives. Knowing the powerful word of the Lord is key to increasing spiritual maturity. It's also key to the book of Isaiah, and it's especially clear here in Isaiah 55. We derive our spiritual maturity from the Bible. And Isaiah 55 is a notable source for telling us that. And there's a pattern in this chapter, and I think it matches the pattern for our spiritual growth. And it begins with an invitation. Look at verses 1 through 3. An invitation. If you're following along in the outline, that would be the first blank there. It says, verses 1 through 3, come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear that your soul may live. So this chapter begins with the gracious invitation of God to come. and specifically to come to him. This invitation expresses God's plan to draw his people out of exile in Babylon and bring them back to Jerusalem. So here's the first principle of spiritual maturity. We come to God in response to his gracious invitation to come and listen to him. And the invitation to come to God, it lies at the heart of spiritual maturity. It's an invitation for a relationship with God. It's an invitation to move towards God. If you think about it, it's actually echoed in the call of Christ in Matthew 11. He says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." It's a gracious invitation to come, and it's gracious because it's addressed to everyone who thirsts, those who are aware of their need and have no resources. He who has no money, come, buy and eat. God's taking the initiative in this gracious invitation. People don't deserve God's grace. It's a free gift. And notice it's a verbal invitation. How do you know to come unless you hear the word of God through the prophet Isaiah? And come means to listen diligently to me, to incline your ear, to hear that your soul may live. They have to listen to God in order to hear his invitation and to hear his promise. How else will they know? They're going to leave Babylon under the protection of God if they don't hear him. How else do we know to turn to God, to come to God, unless we hear and listen to the words of God? The invitation to come is an invitation to listen. No coming without listening, no listening without coming. And this invitation is graciously given in words through the prophet Isaiah. Building a relationship with God through the attentive listening to God's words given through the prophet is fundamental to the spiritual life of his people. And it was true then, and it's true now. It's true for us. So what's the basis of this gracious invitation? Do we have a reason for it? And that's the second point, a reason, verses 3 through 5. And the reason for this invitation is the promise of God that he will accomplish his covenant with David, starting at the second half of verse 3. "And I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you. Because the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you." God's made irrevocable promises to David. And as he keeps these promises, Israel can participate in the blessings. As David experienced God's steadfast, sure love, so Israel can experience God's steadfast, sure love. However, David's long gone now. And it looks as if God's promises to David have failed. There's no descendant of David ruling in Jerusalem. The nations have triumphed over Israel. They're about to triumph over Judah. And yet the covenant promise of God would still be fulfilled. And that word of promise spoken to David so many years ago still remains as the basis for the return of the people of God to Jerusalem and for the fulfillment of God's plan to bring the nations so they see the future splendor of God among his people. So here's the second principle of spiritual maturity. God's invitation is not a last-minute invention, a spur-of-the-moment idea. It's based on God's covenant, which he originally promised to David and which would be finally fulfilled in the coming Christ. So God's promise to David was fulfilled in God's word to his people in Isaiah 55, and would be finally fulfilled in the coming of Christ. The invitation to come to God and his people's leaving Babylon and coming to Jerusalem is based on the promise of God, the character of God, the work of God, the power of God to use people to achieve his will, and on his forgiveness through the saving work of his servant. What God's words achieve in his people, his words achieve for his people. Let me say that again. What God's words achieve in his people, his words achieve for his people. The great promise of God here in Isaiah is to bring his people back to Jerusalem. And they're going to benefit from God's work as they respond to his invitation, his present invitation, based on his past promises. They're summoned by God's verbal revelation. The invitation to come and listen is based on God's ancient covenant promised to David, recorded in the scriptures, and which God now promises to fulfill in the life of God's people. What God promised in the past, he'd fulfill in the present and fulfill in final form in the future. It all sounds good. And actually, it all sounds a little too easy. And it was. Because as God's about to point out, there's a big problem here. It's a big problem. We have an invitation and a reason, but we have a problem. Look at verses 6 through 9. It says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." See, the problem is the people of God had heard God's gracious words before in his promises to David, and yet they disobeyed him, and they had turned away from God. So to the words, "come and listen," the prophet adds, "seek, forsake wicked and unrighteous ways." It's an essential element of spiritual maturity. To come is to listen, and those who come and listen have to seek, forsake, and turn from wicked ways and unrighteous thoughts. Any attempt to respond to God's invitation to come and listen has to face this vast gap between the thoughts and ways of God and the thoughts and ways of unrighteous man. Sin is the enemy of spiritual maturity, just as surely as immaturity is a sign of our sin. The people of God are in exile. Others are headed for exile because of their sinfulness, sins of failing to hear and obey God's words given in the law and the prophets. And we read about that, 2 Chronicles 36. "But they kept mocking the messengers of God, despising his words, and scoffing at his prophets, until the wrath of the Lord rose against his people, until there was no remedy." So coming and listening isn't as easy as it sounds, when the pattern in the past has been to mock and despise and scoff at God's word and God's prophets. You cannot come and listen unless we also seek him and forsake our wicked ways and unrighteous thoughts and return to the Lord. And verse 7 makes it clear that the wicked and unrighteous are those in Israel who judge the Lord by the standards of their own experience, and so they mistrust him. It's a rebuke of very weak faith among those who've professed to be part of his covenant people. It's a call for the people to change their weak faith into a strong faith and to have confidence in what God says. They should abandon their thoughts, pessimism and skepticism and weak faith, which are unrighteous, and abandon their ways, where they're resigned to exile and disobedient to the covenant, which it says here is wicked. But not only abandon their thoughts and ways, but repent. Repentance is integral to our relationship with God while we're in this present evil age. And as Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, there is no cheap grace. No coming and listening without forsaking our ways and turning from those ways to God. And we have to know how big this problem is. It's immense. There's a great gulf between our thoughts and actions and God's thoughts and actions. Look again at verse 9. "For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Through the prophet, God carefully mentions his own thoughts and ways before the thoughts and ways of the people. It's because God's thoughts and ways set the standard for us. We should think God's thoughts after him and follow his ways. His thoughts and ways come first. But there's this great gulf, this vast gap between God and us. And it's no wonder that Israel found it difficult to come and to listen to God. And it's no wonder that we find it difficult to come and listen to God. It's not enough to forsake wicked ways and unrighteous thoughts. The people then and now must return to the Lord in order to find compassion and pardon. So here's the third principle of spiritual immaturity, namely our inability to bridge this immense gap on our own. I mean, essentially, how do we reach God? How can this great gulf between God's thoughts and ways and our thoughts and ways be bridged? How can we hear, how can we come and listen and hear God when his thoughts and ways are in heaven and our thoughts and ways are earthbound and sinful? So the great dilemma of our attempts at spiritual maturity, our attempts to draw near to God. Because we can't climb from earth to heaven. And we can't move from our thoughts and ways to God's thoughts and ways by our own effort. We can't achieve it even by repentance and good works, or by intellect or reason or intuition or mystical experiences or even common sense. So how then can the gulf be bridged? We need to find a solution. Look at verses 10 and 11 and a solution. It says there, starting at verse 10, "For the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it." It's the word of God that bridges the gap between divine and human reality, between heaven and earth, between God's thoughts and our thoughts, between God's ways and our ways. It goes out from God's mouth to accomplish that which I purpose. It's as powerful, effective, and fruitful as the rain and snow that come down from heaven and water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Back in verse 9, the concern was of the distance between heaven and earth, between God and his people. And that gap exists, not just because people are people, not because we're human, but because we're wicked and unrighteous. Our problem is not our humanity, it's our depravity. It's not our humanity that's the barrier to spiritual maturity, but our sin. We've abandoned God's thoughts and ways for our own thoughts and ways, and that's moved us far from God. And so actually, it should be a joyful thing. It should bring forth joy that God himself bridges this immense gap between his thoughts and ways and our thoughts and ways by his word, by telling us what his thoughts and ways are. Furthermore, the parallel between the rain bringing life in verse 10 and the word bringing life in verse 11 is clearly intentional. The word of God is the unfailing agent of the will of God. The effects of God's words are reflected in this comparison between rain and snow and the word of God. So let's look at that. The rain and snow come down from heaven, verse 10. So does my word that goes out from my mouth, verse 11. The rain and snow do not return without watering the earth, verse 10. So my word shall not return to me empty, verse 11. The rain and snow not only water the earth, but do so purposefully and effectively, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, verse 10. So God's word achieves all that he intends. It shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it, verse 11. It's a clear parallel between these two verses. And this is the fourth principle of spiritual maturity. The word of God not only communicates the reality that God's people are far from God, but it brings about a change in that reality as God brings his people to repentance when they hear and obey his words of invitation and covenant promise. God's word bridges the gap. One commentator said, God has come near his people, not only in the work of the servant that's been predicted, but also in the preaching of the prophet throughout the book. It's because what God says is the truth that the word will perform exactly what God intends. Notice also the power of the word of God and how it's asserted both negatively and positively. Negatively, it shall not return to me empty, and positively, it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. God's word is never ineffective. It is always effective. And it's never powerless. It's always powerful. The word of God is the means by which God draws near to his people and makes his salvation effective in our lives. Now, that's not a new thing. The Bible has said that in other places. Long before Isaiah, Moses told the people in Deuteronomy 30 that God's word is not in heaven, that you shall say, who will ascend to heaven for us and bring it to us that we may hear it and do it. It's already here. And then long after Isaiah, the Apostle Paul wrote, Romans 10, the word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith that we proclaim. God graciously bridges that immense gap between heaven and earth by his word, which comes from heaven to earth and always accomplishes his purposes. When you read the Bible, when you sit under the preaching of God's word, God is bridging that vast gap to meet you. And as the gospel is the power of God for salvation to all who believe, so the word of God will not fail. Christ has overcome sin and given us confident access to God the Father. That's what our theme verse for this whole January series tells us. That's what it's all about. Hebrews 4:16. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. True spiritual maturity is founded on that grace in which we stand in Christ Jesus. And then finally, we're given another promise. A promise that the solution, God's word accomplishing God's purpose in our lives, will be effective in solving our problem of being separated from God by our sin. Why have such a promise? Look at verses 12 through 13. A promise. We have such a promise because God's word is not ineffective or powerless, but effective and powerful. So the power of the word of God is of central importance. I've said to you for years that the word of God is powerful in and of itself. Look at it here in Isaiah 55. It's an invitation that comes in the form of words, verses 1 through 3. It's effective because it's based on the hope of an everlasting covenant, covenant made with King David, verses 3 through 5. It's effective because God's people come, listen, seek, call on him, forsake their wicked ways, and turn to a compassionate and pardoning God, verses 6 and 7. It's effective even though the minds and hearts of the people are far away from God's mind and heart, verses 8 and 9. And it's effective because God's word doesn't return empty, but accomplishes God's purpose of bringing his people to receive all that God offers, verses 10 and 11. And it's effective because the results of God's promise and God's word and the results of the people's repentance are foretold by God in a powerful promise of abundant joy and peace. What's waiting for you if you respond to his invitation to come? Suppose you've been wandering away from Jesus, and he's calling you back this morning. Suppose you've never really come to him, you just want the rest of us to think you have. But today, this morning, at last, you finally have. You're returning to the Lord and listening to his word. What's the consequence of returning to Christ going to be? Those consequences are found in this powerful promise of abundant joy and peace, verses 12 and 13. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. And then we get these picturesque examples. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it will make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Furthermore, the word of God comes to his people then and now from the mouth of the prophet Isaiah. God not only stoops to use human words, but to have them heard and read from the mouth and pen of the prophet. It's actually the double condensation of God, this overwhelming grace of God. He not only uses human words, but he places them in human mouths that humans can hear, trust, and know him in his saving acts. Same theme, the power of the Word of God is found back in Isaiah 40, which we looked at last week. There the invitation was found in God's Word to comfort, to speak, to cry, and proclaim. The basis for that message of comfort, you can trust God's Word. Isaiah 46 through 8, for through all flesh is grass, and surely the people are grass. Then we read, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of our God will stand forever. This theme of the fruitful power of God's Word is common throughout the Bible. For the Word and the Gospel of God is effective and powerful and fruitful. Look at Colossians 1, verses 5 and 6. Of this, the hope laid up for you in heaven, you have heard before in the Word of truth, the Gospel which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world, it is bearing fruit and increasing. As it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God and truth. Or how about 1 Peter 1:23? You've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. Or James 1:18, of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. It's the fifth principle of spiritual maturity. God's words are effective, powerful, and fruitful. The great Puritan Thomas Cranmer reminds us of the power of scriptures. He wrote this, the words of Holy Scripture are called the words of everlasting life, for they are God's instruments ordained for the same purpose. They have power to turn through God's promise, and they are effectual through God's assistance, and being received in a faithful heart, they have a heavenly spiritual working in them. Even John Calvin has written, God is true, not only because he's prepared to stand faithfully to his promises, because he really fulfills what he declares, for he so speaks, his command becomes reality. So then, let's wrap it all up. What have we learned about spiritual maturity from Isaiah 55? And obviously, from my earlier remarks, I think this is the great need of the day. Well, first, we come to God in response to his gracious invitation to come and listen to his words. Second, the reason for the invitation to come and listen is based on God's covenant promises recorded in the scriptures. Third, our problem with this is that our thoughts and ways are far removed from God's thoughts and ways because of our sinfulness. Fourth, God provides a solution to our problem. God's word comes from heaven to earth. It never fails. It always achieves its purposes in our lives, primarily by leading us to faith and repentance. And then finally, fifth, God promises that his words are effective and powerful and fruitful and will produce an abundant harvest of joy and peace, sometimes in this life, surely in the next one. And so for Christians now, it's important to remember that God's words through Isaiah remain his powerful words today. God's words in the mouth of his prophet and in his writings are still powerful and effective. The same words remain powerful in our lives and in our mouths as we use them to challenge, to encourage, to rebuke others, whether believers or not yet believers. These words remain the living and active words of God. As the Apostle Peter teaches, quoting Isaiah 40, 1 Peter 1, all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you. God's words, given through his prophet, written down for his people in Isaiah's time, are also written down and preserved for us. Romans 15, for whatever was written in former days, was written for our instruction, that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So having said all of that, we have to ask, why now? Why does Isaiah end this poetic song that he started back in Isaiah 40 with this call to having confidence in God's word as the means to spiritual maturity. It doesn't come out of nowhere. See, the previous chapter, Isaiah 54, is about God's covenant with his people and changing their lives and reversing their difficult situations. If you look at that chapter, there's a barren woman rejoicing over her children. There's a lonely wife comforted by her husband. And there's a poor city that's made beautiful with costly jewels. And so if you want to see your difficult situation reversed, Isaiah 54 logically flows in Isaiah 55's call to return to the Lord. But both chapters, Isaiah 54 and 55, are designed to spell out the consequences of Isaiah 53. And you know, chapter 53 focuses on the work of God's suffering servant, the Lord Jesus Christ. As the written word bridges the gap between God and man in Isaiah, so the incarnate word bridges the gap between God and man in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. John 1:14, the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. That has meaning that the word became flesh. The gospel offers satisfaction, rest, pardon, growth, and spiritual maturity for free, without money and without price. Stop running after what you can only find in Jesus. That's Isaiah's ultimate argument. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. It's an invitation to move towards God. It's echoed in the call of Christ, Matthew 11, as I've already read, come to me, all who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And it's repeated again at the very end of the Bible. When the Bible's coming to a close and God's gracious invitation is thrown out as widely as it could be to all men and women and children everywhere, the language it uses comes right out of Isaiah 55. Find it in Revelation 22, verse 17. The Spirit and the bride say, come, and let the one who hears say, come, and let the one who is thirsty come, let the one who desires take the water of life without price. Revelation is clearly meant for everyone. It's not just for Jews or Greeks or Americans or whites or blacks or Asians or Hispanics or Africans. It's for everyone. And so I can say with great confidence that you've been included all the way through in Isaiah 55. And if you've called on the Lord and turned from your sin and drunk from the water of life, this final promise is for you too. You've been looking everywhere else, some of you, pursuing everything else, and nothing else satisfies. Only Jesus. Come to him. It's a free offer. And who's invited to come? What does the text say? Come, everyone who thirsts. Isaiah's not saying that only the thirsty are allowed to come. He's saying that everyone is thirsty whether you realize it or not. The prophet is telling us that all sinners have a right to come. All sinners are entitled to come. All sinners are invited to come. So are you a sinner? Put your hand up if you're not included in that category of human being, of sinner. Hopefully none of you put your hands up, but I can't see. However, if you are a sinner, then you have a right. You're entitled. You're invited. You must come to Christ. Come and eat. Come and drink. Come and be satisfied. Come and rest. Come and live. I wonder how many of you have ever heard of the story of Shrek the Sheep. Shrek the Sheep, yes, named after the movie character. I mean, seriously, you can look him up. It's a true story. Shrek the Sheep was a merino sheep from New Zealand. Became famous for managing to escape his annual shearing by running and hiding out in caves. And he did it for 6 years in a row. He was determined, apparently, to avoid his shepherds. And he was quite successful at it. Although they say he must have been miserable as a result. See, the average merino sheep's fleece weighs about 10 pounds. And when they finally caught Shrek and got to shear him and take off his fleece, this gigantic fleece, which hadn't been sheared for 6 years, weighed 10 times what the normal one was. They said it had enough wool to make 20 men's suits. Friends, if you've been avoiding Jesus, the Good Shepherd, the weight you are carrying is intolerable. And he says to you this morning, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Isn't it time to get rid of your burden? Isaiah says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Won't you do that? Take a moment to do that now, to call upon the Lord. You need to pray. Take a moment to do that, and then I'll close. Let's pray together. Our Lord and our God, thank you that you have spoken to us by your Son. Open our eyes that we might see our sin and then see our Savior. Thank you for these words of Isaiah. We are a people who need to respond to your gracious invitation to come and listen to your word. We are a people who need to know that your reason for this invitation is based on the covenant promises you've made with your people, covenant promises which still apply to us today. We're people who need to come to you in repentance because our thoughts and ways are far away from your thoughts and ways. And despite our sinfulness, your word comes down from heaven to earth and always accomplishes your purposes in our lives. And it does so because of your promise that your words are effective, powerful, and fruitful, and when we believe and obey them, they'll produce an abundant harvest of joy and peace in our lives. Lord, I can't think of much more than we need right now than joy and peace. So help us to believe your promises, and let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Help us to have real confidence in your word in the midst of this chaotic new year. For we ask these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Well, we've heard God's word. It's effective, powerful, and fruitful, and leads us in abundant joy and peace. And with that knowledge, we can rise up, and we can love, and we can sing, and we can wonder, which is our closing song. So please sing with me. Let us love and sing and wonder. Sing and wonder, let us praise the Savior's name. He has hushed the law's loud thunder, he has quenched Mount Sinai's flame. He has washed us with his blood, he has washed us with his blood, he has washed us with his blood, he has brought us nigh to God. Let us love the Lord who bought us, pitied us when enemies, caught us by his grace and taught us, gave us ears and gave us eyes. He has washed us with his blood, he has washed us with his blood, he has washed us with his blood. He presents our souls to God. Let us sing though fierce temptations threaten hard to bear us down. For the Lord our strong salvation,
holds in view the conqueror's crown. He had washed us with his blood. He who washed us with his blood. He who washed us with his blood. Soon will bring us home to God. Let us praise and join the chorus of the saints enthroned on high. Here they trusted him before us. Now their praises fill the sky. He has washed us with his blood. He has washed us with his blood. He has washed us with his blood. He is worthy, Lamb of God.
Hear the Lord's blessing from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. And we also thank God constantly for this, that when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but as what it really is, the word of God, which is at work in you believers. God bless, and please pray. Get to see you next week. Thanks.